Here, I call this meeting to order. Mrs. Senator, will you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Coghill?
Here.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Here.
Mrs. Inderhart?
Here.
Mr. Matheson?
Here.
Mr. Paulson?
Here.
Mr. Gambiani is absent this evening. Mr. Roman?
Here. Dr. Schuler, would you please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any modifications? Are there any modifications to the agenda tonight?
Roman, I have just one. If it's okay with the board, we have two action items listed, the approval of post the tentative budget and the resolution for the bond. I'd like to switch those two, just the order of the action item. We do have a guest with us for one of those items that has to get to another appointment after us. So if it's okay, if we could switch action items one and two.
Great. Any objections? Hearing none, we'll proceed with that change to the agenda. The next item on the agenda are public comments on the agenda items. We provide the public who attend our meetings two opportunities to speak with respect to public comments. Public comments on agenda items at the beginning of the meeting. Those comments are addressed to agenda items so that the board can consider those comments when we address or discuss agenda items. And then at the end of our meeting, we have public comments on non-agenda items, which can be on any school district-related issue. So we now have public comments on agenda items. And we do have two speakers signed up to speak. Jan Shaw. And Mrs. Shaw, if I can go through the little set of instructions I have here. The opportunity to speak to the board is provided for members of the public who have a question or comment on an agenda item. The board appreciates hearing from stakeholders and values your thoughts and questions. The board strives to make the best decisions for the district, and public input in a variety of venues is very helpful. The board must protect the civility and decorum of the meeting. Please be respectful for the duties of the board and the democratic process in your comments tonight. Please use the microphone, state your name and whether you are a district resident, and address your comments to the board. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Please be factual and courteous, and do not include statements that are personal, disrespectful, or condescending to members of the board or staff. If you feel your matter needs to be discussed in more detail, please attend the board's chance to chat or present your comments to us in writing. Thank you. Mrs. Shaw?
I'm Jan Shaw. I am a district resident. My comments tonight are regarding the personnel report, which was attached to the agenda. I'd like to thank you for actually listing out the administrators and what their new salaries are going to be. That's step one in having the board make an educated decision. Step two would be giving the people an idea of what the people are currently paying, how big a raise that is, or justification for those that are getting larger raises than the average. A couple things I noticed. First off, I went to find old salaries. The 2013-14 compensation report is online. Why is the one from 14-15 not available yet? It should be. As long as we're at it, last month you ratified a new teacher contract. Why isn't that online yet? The old one is. Looking at the list of new administrative salary things, there's three new directors of instruction. Is that a new position? When did you discuss the new position, and did the board approve the fact that there were going to be three new hires for three new positions? Actually, two of those are in promotions, one's a new hire. Why are these people needed? Is it part of Common Core? This is something that should be discussed at the table. When you look at the number of total administrative positions over the years, it has gone way up over the last two or three decades. Number of administrative pursuits way, way up. Next thing, most of the administrators seem to be getting between what we had 2 years ago versus the proposals for this year, a 2.65% increase. However, there's a couple in particular I'd like to call your attention to. Mr. Farley is getting a 4.49% increase over 2 years. His salary is going to be $170,000, while the other assistant superintendent is $156,000. That may be fine. I'd just like to know what the justification is for giving him that much more money. Ms. Lovacato, our PR person, who was hired, the to a brand new job that was created in October 2010. Prior to that, that job was done by the superintendent and some secretaries. In fact, for the most part, I think it was done by the superintendent's secretary. Anyway, Ms. Lapidus' salary 2 years ago was $63,945. The proposed new one is $75,650. That's an $11,705 increase, or an 18.3% increase. Why is she getting 18.3% more when everybody else is getting 2.65? And this is for a job that I never understood why we even have it, because as far as I'm concerned, public relations for a public body is not doing anything for the children. Okay? Way too high an increase. The other thing I want to mention on here is the fact that you need to look at the sick vacation days and personal days. Your senior administrators, you get 2 personal days, 18 sick days, and 23 vacation days on top of their holidays. That's a total of 43 days off, or 8.5 weeks. Other administrators, like the principals, it's 2 personal, 15 sick days, 23 vacation. And the teachers get the personal and sick days, but no vacation days. The other thing we notice is that vacation days can go poof and become sick days if they're not well used. We have at least one administrator, I think that was Mr. Farley, is taking 5 days a year and getting cashing them out for cash. Most people seem to accumulate them over the life of their career, and then they either turn them in for pensionable credit, or they turn them in for cash at the end of their career. We're broke. We can't afford this. There was nothing in the private sector that gets that quantity of days off. It needs to end. And the other thing that needs to end is the district has been picking up the pension payments for most administrators. Teachers pick up their own pension payments. Administrators should do the same. And then there's the health care benefits. Teachers pay, I think it's 20% of their health care benefits. Principals are paying 10%, administrators for the most part pay zip. It's time for administrators to pay just like everyone else. If I'm wrong, correct me, that's fine. But I know in the past that's the way it has been. If you change that, correct it. But do take a look at the amount of time you're giving people off. We can't afford it. Look at these couple raises that were out of line with what everybody else is doing. And please explain why we're constantly growing the number of administrative positions. Thank you.
Our second speaker is Pamela Paulson.
Good evening, my name is Pamela Paulson. I live in Wheaton and I'm a district resident.
Oh, thank you.
Now you should record it all. Okay, is this even on? Okay, is this on?
You have to
have it. Did you shoot it off?
No, it says on. Okay, we'll try this again. Okay, I'll just keep talking really loudly. Okay, I serve as the. All right, I'll start over. My name is Pamela Paulson. I'm in Wheaton, a district resident. I serve as the president of CUSD200, which is the Education Foundation for the district. It stands for Network for Educational Excellence in Wheaton-Warrenville. And speaking tonight is on the agenda. We're gifting almost $16,000 worth of assets to the district. We ended the year really strong by purchasing and donating 40 Chromebooks, which was 2 for every school. Funds for this were raised at the Distinguished Teacher Awards evening, Pizza Palooza night in April. And throughout the year, we've contributed in other ways, such as contributing $3,000 to an online math practice program called 10 Marks, which is for the middle schools. We partnered with SEA200 to purchase 8 iPads for Wheaton North students with special needs. We awarded 6 grants for first grade at Whittier. And we gave a $1,000 check to Franklin Middle School, the winner of the Entrepreneurship Expo. That was just last month. So it's been a really busy year as we rebuild the district's education foundation into a strong community asset. Just over a year ago, we only had 2 remaining directors and about $3,000 in our bank account. To Today we've grown to 6 directors and we hope to keep growing it further. After raising about $35,000 since last June and after contributions to the district, we now have a bank account balance of about $20,000. We recently created a business sponsorship program called Renaissance Sponsors, and we've received donations from 10 companies plus the Wheaton-Warrenville Education Association. We thank the Board of Education and the District 200 administration for their support, also being a Renaissance sponsor. We greatly appreciate all the support from the district, and we thank you for your time and your help as we rebuild the foundation to the benefit of all District 200 students. Thank you.
I know it's not customary for us to make any comments after public comments on agenda items, but the new District 200 Foundation is a wonderful exception. The work that the foundation has done this past year has been remarkable and very much appreciated. And the work that you've done has been even more remarkable and very much appreciated. The foundation is off to a great start this year with all the work that you've put into it, and all we hope is for future success in the future, because it's just a wonderful organization. Thank you very much for everything you've done.
Great, thank you.
Could I second that? Just working hand in hand with Pamela as the board's liaison to the foundation. It's been wonderful renaissance, a great display of energy and enthusiasm, and hopefully we can keep it going and grow it to some of our surrounding districts. We have a good plan in place and good strong people behind it. So thank you, Pamela, for all you've done. It's been really, really wonderful.
Great, thank you.
Seeing that there are no further public comments on agenda items, we now turn to the superintendent's report. Dr. Chula.
Absolutely. I have just a couple of things this evening under my report. Board members, first thing I wanted to mention is in your green folders, there is a sheet from, I believe it's the Illinois Association of School Boards, called the Master School Board Member Activity Sheet. If you do plan to fill that out, there is a deadline of July 31st for completion of that activity. We do also now, partially based on legislative change, but we do keep track online of all required school board member trainings, and so certainly filling out that sheet helps us as well. Make sure that we keep that updated. We certainly have a very active board in terms of your own development, and so I think that's a great opportunity to be recognized for that. So that's in your sheet. Second thing that is in front of you is a little one-page flyer from Representative Ives. She is hosting on July the 15th. A town hall meeting to try to help build a little bit of understanding around property tax and kind of the role that property tax plays in funding a number of local units of government. I'm going to be participating in that town hall along with Don Rose, finance director from Wheaton, as well, along with the Milton Township assessor and the Naperville Township assessor. So again, I just wanted to mention that's July 15th, 7 p.m. and that's going to take place at the Wheaton Park District Community Center. So that's in front of you. I had mentioned to the board, I believe, in a previous weekly update that I had a chance right at the end of June to actually participate in a dinner meeting with the Kiwanis Club, another one of our local community organizations. It was a great opportunity. It took place over at the downtown Leisure Center, the Activity Center, right across from the Van Shell. Great opportunity to meet another group that actually is very, very closely connected with our schools, and that they helped to sponsor the key clubs at both of the high schools. Now, and they also sponsor a middle school service club at Edison. There were actually 4 students there from Wheaton North, even though they're on summer vacation. The Kiwanis Club invites the students that benefit from the support that they give to join at their meetings. And it was great just to see a community organization very much there in support of and with a mission of service. I know we've got a lot of great civic organizations, but it was good to connect with that group. A lot of former educators in that group as well. And then finally, just wanted to mention that conversations continue to go on, I think, at the City of Wheaton in regard to the potential funding sources for the improvement plans that they have for the Wheaton downtown area. They've presented at a couple of recent meetings some of the options that they're looking at. The reason why I mentioned it to the board tonight is that a couple of the options that they're looking at do involve consideration of the extension of a couple of existing TIF districts. And so Mr. Farley and I have continued to stay in very close contact with the City of Wheaton. At this point, they haven't asked for a formal position from our board on it, but I just want to continue to kind of keep that idea or that concept fresh in your mind, because I do think there may be a point in the near future where they do ask if we have a formal position about potentially the expansion of some existing TIF districts. That would have a big financial impact on the school district, and so again, I just kind of want to keep that concept, although it's not for discussion tonight, kind of fresh in your minds, because we may be at a point at some point in the future where we are asked to take a position on that. And I think that's it for tonight. It's July, so no happenings in the schools.
Any questions of Dr. Shuler?
A clarification on the TIF issue. The TIF one is expiring in the near term. Do we have anything in our current year budget for that expiration?
That will impact next fiscal year. That TIF expires at the end of the calendar year 2016.
Any other questions? If not, we will move on to the consent agenda. Please bear with me as I read our consent agenda items. Number one, acceptance of gifts from Longfellow PTA. Two, acceptance of gifts from Westbrook PTA. Three, acceptance of gifts from the New 200 Foundation. Four, acceptance of a technology gift to the Longfellow School. Five, approval to post revised policy 6.50, wellness for public review and comment. Six, approval of the driver education waiver. Seven, approval of the IASB annual dues. Eight, approval of the 2015-16 LUDA membership dues. Nine, approval of Discovery streaming subscription renewal. 10, approval of Gaggle safety management for Google Apps. 11, approval to accept paving alternatives. 12, approval of compressor and installation bid. 13, approval of GCA Services Group custodial cleaning services contract renewal and First Amendment to Services Agreement. 14, approval of print shop paper bid. 15, approval of zero graphic bond paper bid. 16, approval of minutes June 10, 2015, open and closed, and approval to destroy recordings of closed sessions prior to February 2014 as allowable by law. 17, approval of bills payable and payroll. And 18, approval of personnel report to include employment, resignation, retirement, and leave of absence of administrative, certified, classified, and non-union staff. Are there any items board members want removed from the consent agenda? Is there any information from staff about the items on the consent agenda?
Just one comment, though. We recognize the New 200 Foundation and their generous donation of almost $16,000. Just want to point out that the combined gifts from the two PTA groups at Longfellow and Westbrook also total about $20,000, and then there's another individual $900 donation that an individual teacher secured. So again, we really thankful of the New 200 Foundation, but continue to also be very thankful of the PTAs.
I'll ask for a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda as presented.
So moved.
Moved by Mrs. Intihar.
Second.
Seconded by Mrs. Patrick. Mrs. Sender, will you call the roll vote on the motion and ask for board members to vote online?
We have a discussion.
Yeah, if you have any comments, Jim?
Yeah, I do, a couple of items. Item 13 is the approval of the GCA Services Group custodian service contract. And we've had appearances over the last year or two about from the staff, you know, and their issue has been health insurance. I'd be curious whether, how that's being addressed in this new contract and if they're, if it is included or not, and if it is it affecting our cost?
Sure. This what we're asking the board to approve tonight is the third year of a three-year contract with GCA. We are asking the board to approve it at the consumer price index, which is indicated as part of our bid that the contract can only increase by that amount. So we are not going over that amount. We are going using 1.5% CPI. To Mr. Matheson's point on healthcare, employees are being offered and have been given health insurance packets from GCA under the Affordable Care Act. We are not bearing any of that cost. They are not transferring that cost to us. Our contract, again, is only increasing by the Consumer Price Index.
So that addresses some of the concerns we've been hearing about, is that correct? Thank you.
One other comment,
too, I have a question I have on the agenda. We just talked about how much we're approving in the, or accepting in gifts in this session. I'd really like to see a report maybe for the next meeting where we kind of had an accumulation for the year from PTAs, foundations, et cetera, so that we can really focus on that number and identify it on how significant it is and how helpful it is, you know, in a dollar value sense. I look forward to such a report.
I just have one comment as a regarding item 10, the gaggle safety management. As a parent of a student who probably spends too much time on the computer, I really appreciate the fact that that protects our students when they log in, even outside the school, even through their home, through the district account. So protection way beyond the school environment is good.
Any other comments, questions? Not, Senator, will you call roll?
Mrs. Inchehart?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Mr. Matheson?
Yes.
Mrs. Coghill?
Yes.
Mr. Roman?
Yes. Yes.
John, I think you moved too fast to the next item before they voted. Can you please go back to consent?
That should be there.
Who moves?
Mrs. Inchehart and Mrs. Crabtree.
Do it again. Add motion. Oh, wait.
No, you don't want to add a motion.
I have an amount.
Okay, here we go.
Still.
That's okay. Everybody's got an
amount. Okay, everybody's voted.
Thank you. Now it should clear.
Okay. Is that all right up there?
All right, we're moving to the action items. The first action item is the resolution providing for the issue of not to exceed $6,250,000 in general obligation refunding school bonds, series 2015 of the district, for the purpose of refunding certain outstanding bonds of the district, providing for the levy of a direct annual tax sufficient to pay the principal and interest on said bonds, and authorizing the sale of said bonds to the purchaser thereof. I'm to read the following statement. The next item for consideration is the issuance of not to exceed $6,250,000 in general obligation refunding bonds to be issued by the district pursuant to Article 19 of the school code for the purpose of refunding certain of the district's outstanding bonds, and that the Board of Education consider the adoption of a resolution providing for the issue of said bonds and the levy of a direct annual tax sufficient to pay the principal and interest thereon. The resolution sets forth the parameters for the issuance of said bonds and sale thereof by designated officials of the district and summarized the pertinent terms of said parameters, including the specific parameters governing the manner of sale, length of maturity, rates of interest, purchase price, and tax levy for said bonds. Mrs. Crabtree, as Secretary of the Board, would you please read the title of, and the resolution?
Resolution providing for the issue of not to exceed $6,250,000 general obligation refunding school bonds, Series 2015, Community Unit School District number 200, DuPage County, Illinois, for the purpose of refunding certain outstanding bonds of said school district, providing for the levy of a direct annual tax sufficient to pay the principal and interest on said bonds, and authorizing the sale of said bonds to the purchaser thereof.
With all of that, Dr. Schiller, can we please have any information staff would like to share with us?
Sure. I'm going to pass it on to Mr. Farley, who's going to recap where we've been and introduce Mr. Lewis to his comments.
Thank you, Dr. Schiller. Back in February 2014, the board recognized the ability to refund some bonds over a four-year or five-year period of time with four different bond issuances that we could look at. This is the first of those, the smaller probably of the entire group, but we came to the board through the finance committee, proposed to the board to go out and do a direct sale for a short-term bond purchase of about $6.2 million. Tonight, Bob Lewis from PMA, who serves as the district's financial advisor, is going to report out on results, which just ended yesterday, and we're putting together information today, and Bob's going to run through that, and there should be a two- or three-page slide report that's up on the screen and also in your packet, so I'll turn it over to Bob to run through those results for you.
Thank you very much. As Bill's recapped so well, you know, the board was discussing this refunding opportunity last year. I came to a meeting about a month ago just to recap how the process would work. We made a recommendation to the Finance Committee and to the board that we alter the process a bit and go through a direct placement route, thinking that you'd be able to obtain more savings that way. The summary slide you see here has all the salient terms, kind of par amount ended up being $6,140,000. The bonds will be delivered at the beginning of August on the 4th. You have four payments, final of which is November 1st of 18. They are tax exempt, and we are the financial advisor, and the winning purchaser is actually the Niles Township Treasurer. So I said school, I should say treasurer.
Oh, treasurer.
Yes.
So it's not the school district, it's
treasurer. Right. Well, not the township. There's a Cook County schools, a lot of them have treasurers that they pool all the resources at and invest together. And so it's now a township treasurer who represents that area that pools all the funds who purchased it. So here you have a summary of the proposals that are received. In the middle is actually not a proposal, it's an estimate of a public offering. A public offering is the method of sale that we used on your last one, where you actually would have gone through the process to obtain a rating, prepare an official statement, send it out to a multitude of underwriters who would then have purchased your bonds and then offered them to their investors. Because the issuance was so short, it was believed that a direct placement trying to identify an investor through this type of process would be more cost effective and result in more savings. So as you can see, the estimated public offering based off a recent comparable sale, the yields on that comparable sale, we estimated savings to be about $318,000. You actually ended up at $350,000. Niles Township proposal is better than the other three proposals that you received from banks. Chase Bank, we looked at that one, but they had some different terms that that weren't necessary in all the other bids. So that was the best of the bank bids. Here is a summary of the savings. The yellow column is basically taking the difference between the new debt service, subtracting off the old debt service, you get the savings in the yellow column. The fourth year is where you're going to need to start breaking down. Remember, your debt service has that slope. Well, that's about the fourth year as it starts increasing. So that's why we put all the savings in that year to start chipping away at those increases. So this is phase one of the four phases of refinancing, so it's the smallest of the four phases. but we are very pleased with the results that the district received. Any questions?
I have a few questions. Basically, we've discussed this in the Finance Committee, but I just want to make it clear on a couple of items. Did we get any new money as a district from this debt that will be refinanced?
No.
Okay. And is there any cost to the district that we haven't increased debt accordingly?
No, you're not. Okay.
So all we've done in effect is refinanced at a lower interest rate. And that's what's creating these savings over the next 5 years.
Correct.
That first rate.
Yeah, your new rate is the 1.52%, the old rate. I believe these bonds, actually I have it right here. The old rate on these bonds was at 5%.
For the board's information, the Finance Committee met this afternoon with Bob and Bill and Jeff and went over this proposal. This was very good. This was surprisingly good. And the committee was in favor of it.
Thank you to the Finance Committee for overseeing this. Thank you, Bob and Bill. So that in time we can save money without taking money out of the classroom. We're good.
No more questions for Bob. The board does have a resolution. We did update that to because we're working with Niles Township. There's a placement piece to it that's included in the language now as a change on page 17. The board should have all that. We'll ask you to approve that updated resolution tonight.
Any further comments or questions?
You know, I have one other comment too. We had talked before about the direct offering. You mentioned that, and the alternative was a public sale. And the indication a couple of meetings ago when you spoke to us was that this would be a lesser cost to do it this way, and that is consistently what happened, correct?
That's correct.
Are you ready for a motion?
I am.
So moved.
This is not into ours. Moved.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Paulson. Mrs. Senator, would you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Inchehart?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Mrs. Coghill?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mr. Matheson?
I'm going to abstain. I have an affiliation with one of the proposers.
And Mr. Roman?
Yes. Motion passes by 5 votes, two abstentions. The second item is to approve the posting of 2015-16 tentative budget. Dr. Schuler, any information you'd like to add?
Yeah, just again pass it to Mr. Farley, who's going to do a brief presentation on the tentative budget tonight. But I want to offer a thank you both to Mr. Farley and to actually all of the staff in the business office. So I know that the board is very well aware of the fact that bringing a tentative budget to you here in early July is the result of lots and lots of work on the part of the business office and actually pulling pieces together. It's the result of great oversight in bringing to you this evening a balanced budget that we're bringing to you as a tentative budget. So thank you to Mr. Farley and business office staff, and Mr. Farley, I'm going to turn it over to you to make some comments to the board.
Thank you, Dr. Schuler. Going to run through a quick presentation on the posting of the budget. This is the start of a process that, the budget process goes year round, but back in January we asked the board to authorize me to start preparing the budget. We also did our 5-year presentation back in January as well that looked at our PMA model looking forward and incorporated some of that information as we began the budget process. Tonight we're asking you to approve the posting of the budget. The budget has to be on public display for a minimum of 30 days before we hold a public hearing, and with the way the meetings fall, that works out well with the next meeting, and on August 12th we'll have a public hearing here on the 15-16 budget, which gives the community an opportunity to weigh in on the budget as well. And then we are required to approve the budget by the end of the first quarter, which is the end of September. So after the September 16th board meeting, I'll ask the board to approve the budget at that time. As far as the posting goes, we're required to formally post it in the local newspaper. That's the Daily Herald. That posting will be in the paper tomorrow. We'll also put the budget document on display here to the libraries of our communities, as well as online and on the district website. We want to do a quick look back on the current budget year that just ended. As Dr. Schuler mentioned, the fiscal year ended June 30, and we're getting the new budget out. And I do want to thank all of the principals, department heads, assistant superintendents. Usually in the spring, when things are pretty crazy with testing and trying to get the end of the school year stuff done, we're out there pushing budget pages at them and asking them to get it back to us. So part of the reason why we're able to get this done so quickly is the help of my colleagues to the left and all the folks in the buildings who helped us get the budget built. But looking back a little bit here at 14-15, the board just, we posted the monthly report for the end of June, which does give you an indication of how the year ended. It's on a cash basis. Good news to report, we came in on our operating costs a couple million under what we anticipated in expenditures. Revenues are about a couple million under as well, so that matches up somewhat, but I have to carry the caveat that the state of Illinois owes us our fourth quarter payment, which is about $2.5 million, and we will continue to see some federal money come in. So we're hopeful when the audit, which is done on an accrual basis, will pick up that. We're hoping the state will pay us in July or here towards the end of July or August, but as things go, things came in very well this year. Salaries came in very well. Benefits, we had a better year in health care. We still have some wood to chop there, and we're working with the Health Insurance Committee and working through with Blue Cross Blue Shield and our who's our current provider, as well as looking at other options out there in the marketplace on benefits. We're holding that the tech budget. We're continuing to work with Rod on some how we can get the most out of that budget as well. Our tuition line item was another line item. The two big ones from the previous fiscal year, 13-14, tuition and benefits were the ones that were most impactful on that budget, and they were this year. Benefits not as much, but the tuition we've seen increases in that again, and I know Joanne Dr. Panopoulos is working very hard in that area, but it continues to be a cost that goes up quite a bit, and we're seeing our numbers go up as well. Utilities, I've got a columnist plug. We had another great year for electricity and costs associated with natural gas were down. That's his hard work. Mild summer is probably going to help us a little bit too, although we don't really run a lot of air in the summer. And then we had the transfers to capital projects that we did last summer as well that were in the budget. So all of that, just kind of a quick snapshot. We'll provide more information as we move forward and the audit comes in and things of that nature. I want to run through the highlights for this year. The CPI, we just received that number in January. It's 0.8. That'll be the levy amount we levy in December of 15, and that impacts the budget. Tax levy distributions, we're still continuing to see some fluctuation in how and when we receive the money, but the overall distribution compared to the state percentages is still very high in DuPage County, and we're fortunate for that. We haven't gotten preliminary numbers yet on CPPRT, corporate personal property, but that's a large line item that impacts the education and IMF fund. So we're still in a holding pattern on that. Interest earnings, we did see some of our interest earnings creep up a little bit, and kudos to Mrs. Leifert, who does all our investing for us. So we're starting to see some impact on those rates, but they're still historically low. General state aid, I think this is one that I want to pause on real briefly and just mention that the state of Illinois, as most of you know, the budget has, state budget has now been approved. I think the rubber's going to be thrown here pretty soon with state workers and not getting paid and things of that nature. But the governor did approve the education budget. That education budget had legislation in it that set the rate for the overall proration of the foundation level. That had not been in legislation before. That had been determined by the pot of money, and We've been using 89% in our model. 89% is what it was last year. The new state budget calls for 92. We're going to hold it to 89 right now and kind of see how everything plays out, because there's still a lot of uncertainty down in Springfield, and we continue to watch that. So right now we're holding that 89%. Every percentage is about 70 some thousand dollars to the school district in Arizona State Aid. So right now we're keeping it a couple hundred thousand lighter than what was in that legislation, and we'll continue to monitor that. State categorical special ed bilingual transportation costs, those we're still waiting to find out what our overall numbers are. The state has done some proration in some of those areas where we see costs going up in those areas as well, but we're continuing to keep an eye on those. And those we've got estimates in the budget right now. Performance contracting, the grants that we were waiting for from that come through the state, we did not get in this fiscal year budget. We were anticipating this past year, so we're carrying forward some of that money. Mr. Robinson is working closely with our vendor to try and make sure that we can get, hopefully get to catch some of that money that we've gotten in the past. So that's in the budget. And then the federal funding, we're continuing to find out what our carryovers and the amounts we're going to see in title and ID and some of the other programs. The National School Lunch Program is still, we're seeing that the federal government has been pretty good about that. There's a budget question from Mrs. Crabtree about the state and what they're providing at the state level for free and reduced breakfast program, and that amount has actually gone down because participation has gone up so much across the state, they don't have the money to pay. So they just keep reducing the amount that everybody gets because of availability of dollars. On the expenditure side, we have the teacher contract increase that was just ratified with lane movement in the budget. Classified staff is at 1.5%. The administrative and non-union is at the same rate as the teachers. Benefits and health care, we've built in around a 7% number in there. That includes modifications to some of the collective bargaining agreements and changes to the health plan. We're continuing, as I mentioned, to work with Blues and our broker on to see where those overall costs are going to go and see how we finish up our plan year. Actually finishes up in September. With the new plan year starting October 1st, so we're at three quarters of the way through the plan year and working on that renewal, so we'll continue to update the board on that. TRS, we do have a larger, I think the board's aware, we did have a larger year this year. We had four people with penalties of about $460,000 that the district has to pay. As the board's aware, through the collective bargaining agreement, we've taken that ERO provision out of there moving forward, save one person who's already in the track. But we had about $460,000 in ERO penalties that we were paying this year. That's in the budget. We only had $332 in the 6%, and that was just due to some mid-year retirements. We still have the TRS Fed. I know that there's federal legislation now. I read something that there's federal legislation in play to stop the state of Illinois from imposing the TRS penalty on federal grant programs, because so much grant money is going towards that 35% tax on what we used to spend. And I know Joanne and Faith do a good job of trying to spend those grant dollars wisely without having too much of that money going to the federal programs, but it really takes away from the ability to put teachers, use that money, grant money on teachers because of that excessive penalty. And I understand there's federal legislation now to try and stop that, the state of Illinois, from doing that. Last year, TRS lowered that number back down to the appropriate number, and the Illinois legislature moved it back up. So there seems to be some federal push now to fix that, so Illinois cannot do that. So the grants can be used appropriately. Every year also, I just want to mention on the final format that we send to the state of ISBE, we do put those on behalf payments into the document. It's not carried in our budget here. We see here that it's that $37 million on behalf that the state makes for the TRS, for its pension system. Textbooks, we did see, and I believe there's a question on it, the increase in textbooks this year that was related to the science curriculum at the high school.
Elementary.
It's not too good, but this is good. And some other textbooks that had to be replaced, so that was the reason for that increase. Tuition, as I mentioned, special ed, we bumped that number up again due to costs going up and then associated with that program. Technology, again, working with Rod on ways to maximize how we spend in technology. O&M utilities, we were able to make some small reductions in these line items, the line items for gas and electricity. Phone is, we're working with Rod on that. That number has gone up to some degree, and we're, the water seems to keep going up and up, even though we try and use less and less. I know as residents, you probably feel that pinch as well. Capital facilities planning, we have the paving projects that are going on this summer. We have a boiler project and out of our capital facilities plan that's going to be done this summer, but also our planning for the costs associated with our architectural service. Mr. Robinson was out with our new architects walking the building today, so that cost for architect services is also in the budget for our master facilities planning. We do have some work scheduled out of our sub fund of the O&M, which is a capital renewal fund, which is separate from the capital projects fund. As I mentioned, with the custodial service contract and transportation, those are two of our big three contracts. Those are in the final year and in this budget. We also, food services in its first year. Those are the big three for our outsourced services, and all of the costs of those programs are incorporated in the budget. We just got our preliminary number from IMRF as far as the pension rate increase. Kind of goes up and down. Last year it was down, this year it's ticked back up a little bit. Usually the preliminary number is pretty good, and this percentage goes into place on a calendar year basis, so we only feel the impact mid-year, so it starts in January, that the that rate increase that the district paid is going to go up slightly, half a percent. I'm going to run through all the funds briefly, just provide some information on what's going on fund by fund. Obviously, the education funds are largest, 84% of which is coming from local sources, 10% from the state, and the remaining 6% is federal sources. This number is state, some of the percentages have stayed somewhat similar, other than state has dropped over the years as funding has gone down. Total revenue in the ed fund of just under $136 million. This is about a 1.79% increase over the previous year in the ed fund. On the expenditure side, again, 1.15% increase in salary and benefits over the previous year budget. Purchase services, 3.3% decrease. We did see some movement of grant money moving around and some of how we're spending some of the grant money this year. We also have some space holders with some of the programs in the Ed Fund with possible carryover that we're looking at. We also had a decrease in what we're spending for food services. The spend there has gone down a little bit. Supplies is up. This is, again, I think in large part due to how we're budgeting some of the grants and some of the other, how the schools are spending money. Our capital is going up slightly. We have in the Ed Fund about 3.7% increase. News fees and tuitions up 10. Again, that's tied in largely to the cost of the tuition programs I've mentioned a few times. And our total expenditures equal to the is about just under $136 million. And also the 1.79% increase over the previous year. This is just a visual that shows a large part of what we do. The 86% of the education fund is made up of salary and benefits. They're our largest fund. O&M, most of our resources are from local. We do have some state, that's the state money we're waiting on for some of the grant money. Total revenues are just under $12 million. It's about a little bit over a 1% increase over the previous year budget. On the expenditure side, salaries and benefits up about 2.8% over the previous year. Purchase services is a slight decrease. Supplies and utilities, so again, another slight decrease. We were able to reduce some of our gas and electric costs in the budget. And then capital outlay is a little bit larger increase with the architectural services component being included in that line item. And then we have 1,000 in other, which is a decrease. Total expenditures matching revenue is about a little over 1% increase over the previous year budget. This illustrates how the money is spent across somewhat split, somewhat evenly between salaries, purchase services, and supplies. Hey, Bill?
Yes, sir.
Quick question. Go back to one slide. The $750,000, does that, I know we have not only the facility master plan we're doing, we also have a pretty big stock of like 10-year life safety surveys we have to do. Is that?
That's also included in that number.
Purchase services or capital outlay?
That's in capital.
I know we had about $300,000 in the capital renewal sub fund. Is that that $750,000, or is that a different sub fund?
Okay. That's no, that's part of it. That's all part of the O&M.
Okay.
Our bond and interest fund. This is all local revenues. This is paying our bonds, paying principal and interest on the bonds, and our capital lease we have for some of our earlier performance contracting work. So that fund is a balance as well. Again, just wanted to, you know, we talked about it tonight, was the potential to refinance and eliminate the SOAP. We're doing that right now, and we'll be doing that again in the future. Transportation fund, again, this is a fund where we're seeing almost 60% is coming from local sources. That percentage continues to go up as the state funding goes down in this line item. We're almost getting next to nothing now for our regular ed transportation. I guess it's over $200,000 from the state, and that's a number that used to be about $2 million. So greatly reduced. They still fund special ed transportation considerably better, obviously, than they do the regular ed transit. That's about $8.3 million in revenues. It's about 2% increase over the previous year. On the expenditure side, we have some salaries and benefit costs for coaches driving and some of the oversight of the transportation program. Obviously, the lion's share of it is the purchase services because we outsource all of our, the majority of our transportation, and that's tied into an increase that's in the bid. Again, this is the last year for that. One bit of good news, we have a gas escalator that's in the budget or in the contract, and that number has gone down based on decrease in the price of gas. Even though most buses run on diesel, we did see that number go down in this year's budget. And we have $1,000 in there for supplies. So total expenditures matching revenues, and about a 2% increase over the previous year budget. And as you can see, the majority of the cost of spend in transportation is on purchase services. Moving over to the pension fund, it's all local revenue, $3.7 million. It's a decrease over the previous year. We did see this go down, even though we anticipated some, a bump up of about 0.5%. We were able to decrease this as some of those salaries have gone down. Same amount in expenditures, which is a decrease over the previous year budget. What I hit, John? Here we go. Capital Projects Fund, we do have some revenue from that we're going to use this year from fund balances from the projects that came in under budget last year. We do have some remaining fund balance in there, as well as some impact fees we're collecting that we can use for some of the projects that we're doing at the schools that are impacted from developer donations. So we're collecting that on the revenue side. And then we have the projects going on by schools. The board's all aware of them. We did get some good news that our spend on some of those projects were less than anticipated, so we're able to do a little bit more work with staying within the same number. But Week North is complete. Lowell and Edison are almost complete, and Sandberg I saw some equipment dropped off there yesterday, so that school's about to start, and then we're waiting for the ESY, the summer program at Jefferson, and before we start doing the work over there, and I think that ends up with 16. So we'll be working over there after that. Hope to have everything done by the start of school, as well as the boiler project at Jefferson is something that Mr. Robbins working on, we'll be bringing to the board here at a future date. Working cash, $55,000 in revenue. That number's up again. We did see our investment income go up in that in the working cash fund. So that was a bit of good news is from interest earning side. We have no expenditures on that side. So looking at the overall budget, you can see that about $178.6 million budget revenue, 86% of that comes local. Tenants from the state and four federal. This is all the funds of the school district, including bond and interest in the capital projects fund. For our operating funds, which does not include bond and interest or the capital projects fund. This is truly how our day-to-day operational type of things. You'll see that, again, it's about 84% for a local revenue with about almost just about $160 million in revenue for the operating fund of the district. Looking at the expenditure side, $179 million in expenditures. Again, the larger percentage goes to salary benefits. That number obviously becomes higher when we take way back off the bond and interest and capital projects at 77%. And we have operating expenditures for all funds, again, except bond and interest and our capital projects of just under $169. So from an all funds standpoint, the operating balance of the district is about $400,000 in the red, and that's really based on spending down the fund balance in the capital project fund for month fund balances that we have left over. But the budget we really look at is our operating funds. This is, again, the day-to-day operations of the school district, and you'll see that at $160 million right now, again, not including bond and interest for capital projects, the budget is balanced. Just a comparison of year over year for our operating budget for revenues and expenditures, both are up about 1.6% overall. Again, not including bond and interest in capital projects. And I ran through that very quickly, but I will answer any questions. I know the board has asked some questions already. We do have scheduled a finance committee board. Generally, we'll get questions to us that we'll run through the finance committee. Now that you see the budget and it's been posted, and again, we'll have until September 16th for the board to formally approve the budget, so we do have some time, but we do have a finance committee meeting scheduled here in late July to take questions from the board, also provide more information to the finance committee that we'll bring back to the full board for approval. But again, tonight we're just asking the board to post the budget and we'll get it online and get it out there for posting.
I know a number of board members have submitted via email questions to Bill about the tentative budget. Are there additional questions or comments from board members?
First off, I think we have to move to say we're going to post it. Is that correct? I'll make that motion.
I'll second.
Moved by Mr. Matheson, seconded by Mrs. Entehar. Senator, would you call the roll, please?
Discussion.
I asked for
our board.
The process is like get information from the staff, then I ask if there are any questions or comments about the proposed budget. And then after we go through questions and comments, then we can ask for the motion and second, and then we vote.
I thought it was the other way around.
We used to do it the other way around, now we've changed it. So.
Okay.
I was confused. Can I have a comment? Thank you.
We can still have a discussion with a motion on the floor, can't we?
Sure.
Okay. Well, why don't we do that then, if that's okay with you?
Yeah, I would hope, I'm going to preempt one of, I believe we have to post the actual date of the committee meeting. It hasn't been posted yet, has it?
Correct.
In July. Yeah. Correct. But we have tentatively for July 22nd, I believe, for those that may have an interest. And then, you know, I would hope at that time we'll also have some comparative to the actuals of this year, so that we can see that. And, you know, I personally will have a number of questions at that time, but I will reserve them until that committee meeting.
Second.
Any other questions or comments? We have more?
So, kind of going to my question before about how much we have dedicated for capital improvements. We have, is there about $1.1 million total in this budget between the two funds earmarked for capital renewal and for construction? Is that money dedicated to projects this summer that we're finishing, or would it cover any work next summer?
It's mostly for this summer, but there is some work that could occur towards the end of the year. We have about $800,000, a little over $800,000 in the capital projects fund. And we have $300,000 carried in the capital renewal sub fund of the O&M fund. And and then we carry $100,000 for general construction of the O&M fund. So we worked with, obviously, to maximize what money we have left from the benefit of projects coming in good in that capital projects fund when we did the working cash box sale, that we're trying to continue those projects, make those projects up. And then John and I have been working to maximize what we could in the O&M fund to get some of the other work done.
So when we had the presentation by Leggett back in January, February, we talked about the year one, year two, year three. And year one, which I believe was going to be next summer's work, was $10.1 million, which, you know, that's clearly not in the budget. And we have this is a more of a question for the board. We have a policy that allows the board to defer or transfer any excess fund balance over 25% to capital improvements, to capital projects. I'm not necessarily suggesting we do that, but I think it's something worth discussing as a board, whether we want to consider transferring money to begin to tackle that year one $10.1 million target, or is this going to get deferred to year two, and then year two gets bigger and can't fund that. So I think that issue's been identified. The need's not going to go away. It's just going to get more expensive. I think it's something for us to consider once we figure out where the audit goes, how much really we have available in the fund balance. I noted in the financial report we're going to underrun expenditures by about $2.7 million for this past budget, so I would assume that would go towards the fund balance as well. Now, given all the talk we've had about facilities, given all the talk we're going to be having about facilities over the next year, that need is not going to go away. So, 1.1 or 1.2 million is not going to put a dent into the 10.1 million or more we have ahead of us. So, I guess I say that for discussion, perhaps.
Any other comments or discussion?
I wholly agree with Brad's comments that we're not really in this budget. I mean, even the 1.3 is even just some general maintenance in there, is it not?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not even, in many respects, the 1.3 isn't even eroding into any of the $10 million I think you referred to in year one of the, I believe it was a $53 million plan. So, you know, this budget is not financing basically any of that. You know, the deferred maintenance, the deferred whatever. So it is clearly a challenge that we're going to have to deal with in the future here. So, also, just as long as you brought that up about the excess revenue or expenditure, I'm looking at the current financial report, and I, you know, again, that we'll talk about it a little later, but, you know, I'm not seeing where, you know, when I look at that report that's in our packet, I'm seeing overall fund revenue of, all funds of $219 million. And then $228 million expended. Some of that is the erosion or the spend out of the unspent $10 million, if you want to call it that.
Some of that, and it's again, loans are included in that as well. So, you and some of the loans are still in transit. So, okay. You know, if you look at that, I think what Mr. Thompson was looking at probably was the following reports that show the cash actuals, revenues, and expenditures. I think you're looking at just the cash positions page as opposed to what Mr. Paulson was looking at, is the actual spend versus the budget.
Okay. I guess the underlying question then is, what do we anticipate in the operating funds for the year ending June 30, 2015 to be an excess or deficiency that would be potentially available to transfer?
I would probably be able to better answer that once I know what the state of Illinois is going to do with the 2.5+ million they owe us. I think it's appropriate to wait until we see what the audit comes in with the accruals, because that's what the Illinois State Board of Ed looks at as far as what they consider, you know, and what we use for the calculation for that 25%. So I think that's definitely appropriate to wait until that time to see where our position is and see how the accruals come in. I can tell you what we did on a cash actual basis. And again, I think it's important to remember, last year the state got caught up on their categorical payments. This year, there's no, you know, carryover money on a cash basis from previous fiscal years. The state caught caught up last year, so it's not, we're sitting on three categorical payments right now. Even when they were behind, we used to get four because there'd always be one or two that were lapsing and two, you know, there's always that delay, but somehow four always seemed to get to us, and this year we're sitting on three. But even as Mr. Paulson mentioned, we're a couple million under in revenue and we're a couple million under in expenditures over what we budgeted. So I think we're, you know, it sounds like we'll be in a pretty good position when everything's said and done. Again, assuming the state gets those payments to us here in the next couple months, at some point the auditors will, as you know, will draw the line in the sand, and then that money falls into a following fiscal year. So that the fact that we didn't spend as much as we budgeted is going to be very helpful at this point.
And I'm not necessarily proposing that we spend down a percentage of the fund balance, because when we transfer stuff on working cash, you know, we brought to other funds to pay the bills until we got the revenue. And I think if I recall, it was a pretty low number we had remaining. So it's, the value of that fund balance is critical, whether it's 25% or even greater. We passed this policy in April of last year, which says the board may transfer any such balance to the capital projects fund. Again, I'm not suggesting you do it, but that 10.1 million in year one and then the following years, it's not going to move. It's going to get more expensive. I mean, the whole notion of the construction industry, you know, needing work because of the recession is long since passed, and the costs are going up right now.
If I may comment on that though as well, I think we need to be very cautious. And I think we had this discussion back then, because as our budget continues to grow, that 28% may be the same number in terms of dollars, but may end up being 25% because the denominator, you know, changes on that fraction. So I think we have to be very, very careful before we start moving that money out. I totally agree with you, what needs to be done needs to be done, but, you know, I think we have to be really cautious because we don't want to go below the 25%.
I have one other panel question, and that is that we just settled a contract, and part of that contract called for raises of a 1-point-something% in the first year. We also had a significant number of retirees going into next year, and you know, overall we're showing about a 1.5 or 1.1% increase in aggregate spending in the education fund. How does that all make sense? I thought, again, there was some reduction because of the reduce in, you know, the retirees offset by some of the increases we put in it, and I'm not seeing that in that item.
It's not this year. That's 16, 17.
Are you talking about when we have 60 staff retiring this year? That benefit will be in the following fiscal year. But for this year's budget, we did have some reduction in staff. If you look at the other expenditure report, we came in under on salaries, so that's some of it. We also have our right now looking at maybe being down for UFT as well. So I think we're seeing some of the benefit. We do get some benefit from the 14 or 15 that retired this year as well. So
so it's next year.
The big one though, yeah, is okay. Next year when we have, I think, somewhere in the ballpark of 60 going out, and we'll feel the benefit of that in the following fiscal year.
Okay, and then the other item, is there any significant program reduction in this budget?
No.
And just to be clear, Bill, the salary benefits, although they went up more than 1%, that also included in that a 7% increase in the health insurance premium cost. Is that correct?
Yes.
Offset by some reduction or cost sharing with the teaching staff or the staff.
I guess my point is that the salaries actually decreased because we had a 7% increase in health insurance premium costs that were net savings that were achieved through the collective bargaining process.
For years now, it's been amazing how come on budget and get through every year, and then the discussion is always, you know, what our facilities need, and it just gets put off. And I'm just wondering, can we get a plan of when we really seriously discuss what we're going to do about it? that in the future.
Yeah, the facilities committee will be coming in once in the fall with some proposals. We work with Perkins and Lowe that we hired.
So they'll come up with a big picture and timeline and all that, but then the next step will be how to pay for it. So that will be finance committee, all of us kind of, you know, is, have we hit the wall finally, is what I'm wondering.
That's a big question,
Joanne.
We've
been about 5 years to say you hit the wall.
So, yes, the facilities committee is looking at it. Finance committee will be looking at it. I think learning and teaching will be looking at it because we're going to be considering 21st century classroom and education.
Community engagement
engagement will be looking at it because we need to get the community, we need to convey information to the community, get feedback from the community. Human resources will be looking at it because we'll have to staff those classrooms somehow and find ways to pay for it. So I think all of our committees will somehow be keeping an eye on it, and I think it's behooves us to work in coordination with each other on that process, but it's going to be a challenge.
Jim, if I can just mention, I think what's at the core of your question is, are we in the next 12 months going to likely get to the discussion about what is the need and how are we going to fund it? And I believe the answer to that is going to be yes. It's not, I mean, I think it is something that we've acknowledged the need and kind of kept saying, we're going to get to it, but yeah, that is absolutely a part of that facility master planning process. It has a definitive timeline to get us to the discussion on what is the need, how we're going to talk about funding options to address the need.
The other question I had is not really about the budget, but I think when we post the budget, do we also include the presentation for people who could maybe not comprehend the complexity of the budget? This is a lot more noticeable or absorbable, if that's the right word. And then are we going to also, we do the weekly email or the Friday Focus on Learning, post a link to the budget as well as this?
Yeah. We will use every communication mechanism we have available to let people know that the budget is posted.
Doesn't mean we'll get any comments, right?
You know, one comment on that, you know, to maybe address the comment earlier, we talk about a public relations or, you know, person in our staff. It's really a public communications. And in just what we're talking about right now, the posting of that is all basically under the supervision of that department or person or whatever you want to call it. So, you know, I think that the term public relations is probably a misnomer because it really is a public communication document that department, I guess, really is. So, you know, maybe we ought to think about renaming that department sometime to avoid that confusion.
That's a great comment, Jim. Any further comments? We're posting the budget, okay? Mrs. Senator, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Matheson?
Yes.
Mrs. Interhart?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mrs. Cockhill?
Yes.
Mr. Roman?
Yes. That completes the action items. And now we move on to discussion items. The first discussion item is the Citizen Advisory Committee, the charter and the bylaws for that committee. And Dr. Shu, do you have any comments?
Sure, just a couple here in introduction. Again, I want to take the board back a couple of meetings. So the origin of the discussion about a Citizens Advisory Committee came out of a broader community engagement plan. And so I just want to ask Mrs. Lacano to just make a couple of quick comments here at the onset on kind of where this came from, because CAC, the Citizens Advisory Committee, is really one facet of a broader plan that you talked about. And I, as we get into talking about that one little piece, I don't want to lose sight of the fact that it's part of a bigger engagement plan. So, Eric, let's start.
So I put another copy of the placemat in your green folders. So it's folded in half. So in May,
The board heard our plan for engaging our community in the activities of our school district to continue to work with our community to determine priorities, foster partnerships, and promote student learning. And so the Community Advisory Committee, as Dr. Schuler mentioned, is just one part of the broader plan. You'll notice it's mentioned on the right-hand side under two-way communications. And it, again, it's one bullet point in each one of the quarters that you'll see. And really, you know, for us, finding new and creative, strategic, structured opportunities to engage our community in two-way conversations is not always easy to do. Those one-way communications, the written communications, whether they're electronic or on paper, are easier to do. We have one-way communications with our parents on a very regular basis, but those ongoing two-way conversations with all members of our community are not always as easy to come by unless you create some type of a structured environment for that to happen. And so this Community Advisory Committee is that, what we believe is that structured opportunity for the board to continue listening to the community. We really started that targeted effort through our Engage 200 program, and this is really, in my opinion, an extension of that Engage 200 program that we started. And this also allows for us to engage, create an opportunity for significant involvement for people who are interested in volunteering in our with our school district and getting involved, but also creates a group that meets regularly in a structured environment that is very informed. So they not only will be asked to discuss issues, but they will also have an opportunity to hear a full-on budget presentation, perhaps, and really get to understand how school finance works. You know, really get to understand what student learning looks like. And so this is an opportunity to create that regular, informed group of people that meets in a structured way and provides that structured feedback to the board and is representative of the district.
So with, again, with that said as an introduction, I think as we talked with the board and to make maybe the whole meeting about the concept of an advisory committee, I think the board very clearly said yes, we'd be interested or we'd like to at least see what an advisory committee could look like. And so we did bring back to you a proposed charter. There's a lot of detail, I think, in that charter in terms of the structure of that advisory committee. And that was very intentional, I think, in making it clear that if we're going to launch an advisory committee, at least for me, I think essential that it have a real clear charter mission, that its relationship to the Board of Education, to any of the other structures you have is really made crystal clear, and that's why there's that level of detail in the charter. You don't have to have that level of detail of what's in the charter to have an advisory committee, certainly. At you know, either the administrative interest or the board's interest, you could create an advisory committee without kind of this layer of structure behind it. But just in my experience in working with advisory committees in other districts previous, this level of structure kind of always gives you something to come back to year over year as you continue to introduce new members, as you consider to wrestle, as you continue to wrestle with questions of, is it truly representative of the community as new members get inducted and kind of wonder what that role is in relation to the board. I think this type of structure proves to be very useful for the community, so for the Board of Education. So really the interest tonight, I think, is just in getting feedback, questions, concerns. This is not scheduled for action tonight, really just scheduled to hear your thoughts on one, is this sort of along the lines of what you were thinking as a Board of Education, what questions, concerns you have. So with that, I'm gonna stop talking and listen.
Mark?
Well, I appreciate having the charter. I think it's a charter and bylaws I think it's very, very good structure, and I think the structure is needed, definitely needed. My only comment, I guess, is in the, you know, the membership. I'm just thinking that it's going to be really hard with 20 schools and that big group of people to have just five people nominate people who should be on the committee. I mean, I don't know how else to do it. Maybe, you know, principals from their areas, you know, we've talked a little bit about that, and some other school districts have that kind of a model. But I think, especially if we're going to have concerns from board members, thinking, do we have the right group of people? Are we listening to the right people? I don't have any good suggestions on how to make it work in practice, but I think that might be the slippery spot or the Achilles heel, you know. But I think what you've laid out is very structured and very good. Getting it off the ground, I think, is going to be a big challenge. I think if we were a smaller district, it might not be such a huge challenge, but with the 20 schools and the large geographic area that we have, and then the diversity in the community in terms of non-parents, parents, seniors, young people, you know, how are we going to get 36 people? I think that's what you have, the max of 36. How are we going to get all those interests represented to the satisfaction, you know, because of all our different points of view on the board? But I think, you know, it's a good plan, and I do like the structure.
I think it's good.
Chris?
I had a couple questions, too, in piggybacking on what Barb said. I guess when I read this, I understood there was going to be an application process that people, anyone in the community could apply to be on this committee. And my question is do we have an idea of what that application looks like? And, you know, there were so many variables of what we want to cover and try to fit it in that small number of people. I want to be sure that we're getting that a good portion of that community that's maybe not represented within those 20 schools. And how do we make all of that fit, other than, you know, getting a parent who's in three different schools to represent those three buildings? You know, I'm just trying to think of how we go about doing it. So I was curious as to what the thought process was there to make sure that we're doing it in a time frame too, because not only do you have to get the applications out there, then you have to get the committee together to review the applications to then decide who's going to be on the committee. And I guess I was looking at, you know, that this first year ends in 2006. I mean, are we looking to have something like this ready to go right away in the fall? Are we looking more of a January process? So those were my questions.
So let me clarify just a couple of those pieces. So the subcommittee that's referenced in the charter would really, at least in past experience, has been the subcommittee responsible for reviewing the applications that have come in for the committee and helping to, in essence, bring a slate of, you know, kind of nominations forward within the committee. I have in a previous district used an application process. You don't have to. You could go out without an application process, but I think the benefit of having kind of an application process is it does allow anybody who's interested in the community, in that being involved in this, to express interest in being part of it. I do have a sample application that I could share with the board. You know, typically an application I've seen in the past just allows you to gather some information on kind of who the individual is that's applying to be a part of the committee, what their current relationship is with the district, if any, meaning do they have students and our children in schools, not how long have they been in the community or kind of in the area. I've even in a previous application, asked for the individuals on that application to actually list a couple of references that may have worked with them in some type of of piece. Not that you're necessarily going to go to that level of depth and checking references, but I think it kind of gives you a feel for the type of involvement that the individual has. I think, you know, the job of ultimately, you know, kind of pulling together eventually a slate of 36 members of the advisory committee, there's not going to be a perfect science to that, and I think in the first year we're going to have to kind of do the best job that we can to pull together a group that we think is truly representative of the community, and you know, if we don't fully hit the mark in the first year, there will always be a process of a portion of that committee turning over that allows us, if we feel like there's an underrepresented, you know, group within the community, to try to do a little better job of, you know, of drumming up some interest in that. But it's not going to be perfect in the first year. But I think to the last point, my goal would be to get this launched in the fall, get the committee up, get it started. I do think the first part of the year is going to be a lot of organization and getting the committee launched. Ideally, the ideal time to kind of do that application renewal would be in the spring of each year, so that you have a slate to the board in like May, June, right at the end of the school year for the following year, so then the committee's always ready to come together in the fall and kind of start its work for the upcoming year. But I think in the first year, very realistically, I think by mid to late fall, if you could get, we could get an initial committee up and you know, going there, it's gonna take a meeting or two to just kind of set the charge for that committee and truly get them working. So, but I think it's realistic for the fall.
Do we have a plan to maybe get those applications to all these different groups that you are meeting with, maybe as a way to get at some of the people that may not directly have children in our schools, since you've already started developing a relationship? I don't know if that was a natural fit.
I think that would make a lot of sense. I don't have that plan yet, because I guess I'm kind of waiting for the go-ahead from the board to actually start the process of securing applications. But yes, I think we do have the benefit of a lot of existing relationships that can help us in securing potential members.
A couple of questions regarding just kind of terminology. Number five, this is a committee created by the Board of Education that's going to be subject to the Open Meeting Act. Do the members of the committee have to go through the training like the board, like we do as a board? They just have to be aware of it.
I think they just need to be aware of what the Open Meetings Act means. I don't believe they formally have to go through the Open Meetings Act training as a member of the elected board, but I think they need to fully understand what that means.
Okay, and then the second question, I think, is related to 15B. This was a conversation that was important in the discussions about the H200. It talks about the membership. You know, a quorum of 60% of the current membership shall be required for the CAC to take official action. And so, remembering the conversation we had about what the role of the steering committee was about recommending versus deciding, is that, do we need to define what official action is, or does it need to say official, to take official recommendation, or to decide on a formal recommendation? It just seems to me that language might be a little bit too strong, or insinuating to the members that they get to make decisions.
Yeah, that's fair enough. We can tweak that word a little bit to soften. I will tell you, I don't anticipate that this group is going to take a lot of official action. I think the benefit of the group is going to come in the discussion that you're going to see around the issues that either as a board you ask for them to wrestle with, discuss, or bring, or that they perhaps on their own, you know, start discussion. I personally think that's where the benefit of this group is going to come from, because I think they're going to naturally help you as a board, as you're wrestling with an issue, really be cognizant of all the thoughts that are out there in the community around, you know, that issue as well. So I don't anticipate the group's going to take a lot of official action, but I think what that's just saying is, in order for that group, even, you know, something as simple as approving minutes from the previous meeting and doing that, you know, that I think that's a way of affirming to the committee that we need them to be there in order for the committee to function and work well. 36 members isn't going to do a whole lot if only 10 of them are showing up for the meeting.
I guess then the other thing that may seem kind of ridiculous to me, but do we need to, or to the group, but do we need to clarify that this is a volunteer committee, that that's not necessarily in this, that there's no compensation, perhaps, you never know how somebody might interpret it.
We can certainly do that in how we advertise the committee.
That's true. Yeah, I have a number of comments as well. I think the concept of this is a very, is very wishful, I'll call it. I think if we can get the right thing in the right place and get it all done, that's great. I think that's, it's going to be a difficult task to get that done. You know, at times I think that, you know, we're going to get only people that are actively involved with this, but parents of students. And then, you know, I say to myself, well, why would people that don't have children in school be so actively involved? And then I look around at our board and I realize that more than half of our board are those people. So, you know, so there are people in the community like that, and I appreciate that. But I think that, you know, we have to make sure that we create a forum for this to hear that minority or the silent majority opinions. And, you know, and that's going to take the ability for the group as well as the board to hear the things we may not want to hear at times. You know, we've talked about this off and on over the last year, and sometimes we have 6-1 votes, 5-2 votes, and I don't know that we always recognize that the negative votes or the no votes are a reflection of community member concepts. So I'm sure these people that are voting no, and I do this myself, are not, that they're giving serious thought to these conditions, and you know, for whatever reason, are reaching a conclusion. You know, we're looking at property tax freezes that, you know, we talked about back when we passed the certificate of levy. And, you know, I felt we were a little aggressive on one of the board members who may have voted against that. Well, this could be the law of the land shortly. So I think we have to be able to accept that position. We can't always have positive, 7-0 votes, and we have to clearly get that recognition of the no votes. And that's so important even on this committee. If we don't create a forum that to draw people of the mix of the community and encourage that contrary opinion, it's not going to effectively do what we want to do. So, you know, it's very important for me to support this concept to basically assure that we're going to do that, because I don't want a rubber stamp committee, I'll call it. And because it won't get us anywhere, it won't achieve anything, it'll probably create more negative response in the community than, and I don't want to get into the last referendum, things like that, but I think we had too much one-sided opinion, and we didn't really approach the old, both sides well enough. So, and I think that's our role, to make sure that there's a clear understanding of both sides, and that we encourage people to comment accordingly. So, I think that's a real challenge of this committee, or any community engagement. And we've attended the III conference, and we heard we sat in community engagement, that every school district is challenged by this, and every district is trying to figure out a way to communicate with their electorate, and every district is having a challenge just like we're trying to do. So if we can learn something from what we did in our community engagement program and modify it and address the people and make sure we listen to the contrary opinions, that'll really be a great achievement of a program like this. And I hope that is the ultimate goal if we do move forward with this. And, and that's going to be a lot of the mix and a lot of the encouragement we give to this group and the way we encourage them to be, again, be really open and really comfortable with listening to criticism. So that would be my biggest concern with this, which is kind of what I thought I heard Barbara say as well. So, that's really critical.
Any other comments? Joanne?
I just thought it's a great idea from the get-go, and I'm confident that you'll be able to get a cross-section of people, and hopefully they don't turn over, but you can have some consistency in people to commit their time and efforts, and just to Well, I'm sure you'll hand them. If there's a discussion, you'll give them information and they can pick up and so forth. But absolutely, we need to be open. I guess it wouldn't be good, for sure, it wouldn't be good if, you know, they have discussion and maybe, but they're going to be like us where we're not maybe all going to agree. But if they come, you know, always give suggestions and we always, you know, just say, oh, thank you, but, you know, then just go our merry way, that would make them feel very, you know, then it would fall apart. So, yeah, I would love to get more opinions and we'll be discussing things. So I have to break down that.
I hope totally endorse this approach, Dr. Shure. We have thought at one time that we would have a facilitating team of the community engagement be kind of like a sounding board for us, but we didn't have a chart, an outline of what the relationship would be established between the facilitating team and board as you have here. And I think we can tweak it to meet some suggestions we've heard from some of the board members here. It's been a constant struggle, even before I got on the board, for us to have a communication with the community, meaningful communication with the community on important items. And by communication, I mean two-way conversations. And it is a struggle to get that. But we can't stop trying. And I think we've got to go ahead with this sort of concept and get it going. I want to emphasize that in paragraph 7D of the proposed charter here, and this is critical. It says here, the membership of the CAC should reflect the diversity of the citizens of the district, allow for representation by parents from all attendance centers, but also include non-parents, persons favorable and critical of current school policies, large and small taxpayers, owners and non-owners of homes and businesses, long-time and newer residents of the various communities and groups within the district boundaries. That's what we want to get. And I think if we can emphasize this and publicize this in trying to enlist volunteers to come and be members of the CSC, we can get that diversity that we so desperately want on this committee. So do what I think you need to do to tweak it, to meet some of the suggestions that were raised here, some of the great suggestions. And at the same time, maybe our director of communications will be able to really be assisted by such a concept here.
The other thing, just kind of, you know, addressing some of the points, you know, that Jim brought up as well, I do think it's important, and I think sometimes we may have issues around, you know, negative criticism or whatever, but I think what we have to realize in this committee is the people that are selected to be on this committee have to want or have to have in their heart a feeling of what's best for their community and what's best for the school children as part of their community. So I think as long as that's in their heart, I think then disagreements can be dealt with. I think we have problems when we disagree for philosophical reasons or whatever, or we're not understanding each other's point of view, but I think in the end, if we could get people involved in this community who truly have the motivation that's needed and they're willing to solve problems and work through problems, I think that's the best thing we can have. I know we've always tried to strive to have a problem-solving board, and I think it's just so important to have any kind of committee like this be one who is willing to look at problems, provide input as to how those problems can be solved, to provide ideas as to how we can grow and how we can become better. And I think that is a very important criteria. And then if I'm coming from that same bag and I disagree with you, well, then that's, we disagree because we, but our interest is the same, our hearts are in the same place. And that's kind of where I like to see the people, you know, kind of the game, and I'm the main criteria for choosing this.
Any other comments?
And the application process will help that too, because if I'm not, my heart's not in the right place to be glad I'm not going to apply.
Agreed. That last thing though, I just want to again continue to say and remind both the board and anybody in the community that might be interested in this is that this is not the end-all, be-all, only solution to community engagement. This is one part of a bigger, more inclusive process. There are going to be people that are not going to be comfortable with getting involved in an advisory committee that has, you know, a 6 or 7 meeting commitment over the course of a year, or, you know, there are going to be people that may prefer to still just get information that comes to them or participate in some of our broader community engagement efforts. And I think also then for you as a board, I think the goal of the advisory committee is to give you one more voice that you can listen to as you're making decisions. But again, this does not mean this is the only, or that I'm suggesting this is the only opinion that you listen to, obviously, as you're making a decision. For me, it's just intended to give you one more perspective to consider, that you kind of know where that perspective is coming from, you know who's involved in formulating that perspective. But again, you know, as board members, you still have the decision-making responsibility. You still have all of the other sources of information you've always had in helping you to guide toward decisions. I just think it's one more tool.
All right, the next item for discussion is the Vision 2018 and the board goals for 2015 and 16. And again, Dr. Schuler.
Yeah. We did include in the board packet kind of a final summary of the four goals that the board had established from this year, just a way of reminder, the four areas from the Vision 2018 chart that you had prioritized and built in the goals this year included the facility master planning process, a focus on professional development, a focus on technology, and a focus on alternate sources of revenue. And so we did some final updates to that. I think very clearly of the kind of those priorities you established this year, none of them go away. I think kind of the discussion tonight is, as you think about other areas that you may want to pull out and sort of make the strategic focus, you know, for the coming year, the facilities goal, I think, has to continue. Obviously, that's a huge, you know, goal for you. I think we have built professional development into kind of an ongoing annual plan that you're going to monitor anyway, and so I think it will continue to become, you know, kind of a system, you know, goal for us. A couple of other things that I do want to mention off of the Vision 2018 chart that I think you may want to consider for the coming year. From a curriculum instruction standpoint, there is going to be a huge emphasis in the coming year on science. As we look at, you know, the science standards, that's, I think, in the top bullet under the teaching and learning chart. As we talk about building out a you know, core curriculum in reading, language arts, and science, I think science may be, you know, an area that you want to continue to focus on. I think technology continues to be, you know, a central area of focus. We are going to be doing some strategic work next year as well around teacher evaluation. Fall of 2016 is the deadline where we have to have measures of student growth incorporated into the teacher evaluation plan. So I think that, you know, is a good area to perhaps, you know, think about sort of building out as a strategic, you know, goal for next year. And then I think, as we've talked a lot about the Citizens Advisory Committee that you've just talked about, I think the element under community engagement that I think it really highlights is our ability to leverage partnerships to support the operation of the district. That I think is the bottom bullet on that community engagement, you know, strand of things anyway. So I just wanted to sort of plant a couple of those seeds in discussion, but really I think, you know, sort of focus tonight is a couple of questions. One, does 2018 still kind of represent the plan of work that you feel is important for the district? What areas do you want to focus on for next year? And are there any areas that were sort of strategic focuses for this year that you want to roll over into next year? Kind of reloaded questions, but.
Well, we've talked a lot about facilities. I think facilities clearly it's going to continue. And I think the technology portion is going to continue to be more and more refined. I think within, and those two things certainly go together. I think the one thing that I'm kind of intrigued by or curious by is, you know, we've kind of moved away from a technology model of that has a device in every student's hand. We've talked about, you know, let's focus on how do we make sure every student has access when needed. I'm not totally clear on what that is. How do we accomplish that? So, you know, is there a goal or vision that we do, or initiative we do this year to define that so that it can feed into the technology plan? I think that's the one area that I've struggled with, and as we focus on some moving number that gets closer to one, if we're not going to get there, what is access mean?
Why do we have to have a number?
I'm not suggesting we have a number.
Okay.
I'm suggesting.
I thought you were heading down.
No, I'm not suggesting we have a number. I think we moved off of that, and we've talked about making sure every student has access when needed. So what is that? How do we get that?
How do we know that
right.
we have achieved that?
Right.
That's a good. Okay. So how do we know that we've achieved?
You're asking more about a kind of a definition of universal access, not necessarily a number.
Right. Exactly.
I think in that same vein, you know, we compare ourselves to peer districts all the time. You know, I think it'd be really important to hear what our peer group districts, you know, where they're at a little bit on technology, for instance, and kind of update us in the same vein. I mean, if everybody is one-to-one, if we aren't, and we, you know, I would like to make sure we justify why we think that's the correct method. So I think, again, we have a peer group that we always talk about, and I'd like to maybe get some further information you know, throughout the year on where we stand comparatively.
In the era of student learning, I think, and I saw Joanne left, but I think this is going to be a pretty critical year as well with social emotional learning, as far as from what I, you know, recall from where we're at with our committee. So I mean, I think science and that might be years of emphasis on the student learning.
Jeff, you mentioned how we can leverage partnerships and perhaps raise revenue from alternative sources. How do we measure that? I mean, I know we have somebody who applies for grants, Kathy DiMarzo has been helping with that, and others. But have we expanded? Are we expanding that opportunity to pursue grants beyond the traditional educational grants? What sort of partnership opportunities are out there that we can take advantage of? We've also talked in the past of having maybe somebody in the position of a development director or like a development director to see if we can raise revenue from alternative sources. It's something I'd like to see us expand or investigate research.
On that front, we also talked about any kind of policy adjustments we need to make to better enable people to give us money. So we speak to us. That might tie into the same broader goal of partnerships.
And I think the Citizen Advisory Committee can help in that respect too. You know, we're tapping into people within the community that might know of other possible alternative resources that we haven't looked at that are maybe non-traditional things that and can maybe bring that to our group too.
You know, I've recently gotten involved with the College of DuPage Foundation, and you know, a big emphasis they use there is the network of alumni, I'll call it. And I think it's really, you know, I don't know where, you know, I know the Newtown 200 Foundation is addressing some of this, but I guess can we be more supportive in that drive? I know I get mailings, and I'm involved with mailings that send it out for College of DuPage as well that are directly related to alumni events. And I see, you know, I spend a little bit of time at Arrowhead playing golf, and I see a lot of golf outings, and I see them, you know, a lot of school-related golf outings that, you know, are, you know, again, I don't know where that money ends up, you know, whether it be the you know, Wheaton South or, you know, Wheaton-Warrenville South or whatever. So I think we have to watch what we don't infringe on, but I, you know, that's clearly driven by alumni. You know, so I think that we have a long history here, and maybe we need to approach that alumni, you know. So, you know, I think the question is how can we be more supportive to organizations such as the new foundation or 200 Foundation to, you know, to get that going, you know, whether that's our Department of Communications or whatever, but, you know, some way to further develop that in this year. Because I think, you know, we are clearly challenged in all these things, you know, is financing all of these activities. And you know, this year is going to be a very interesting year from state funding and, you know, all the impact that's going to be happening here, you know, at the state level and how it's going to affect education and so on. So, you know, I think we're going to have to be really flexible and start looking for a lot of new sources as we move on here, or we're going to be just cutting programs to try and, you know, fund what limitations are going to be placed by the economics. So.
Just a side note. Somewhat funny story. I just got back from California, and my son's family, they're renting, and just renting, they can never afford to buy, in Laguna Beach. And this is a very wealthy area. And if you can imagine, the kids have a whole set of books at home and a whole set of books at school, plus they have the laptop or something, right? But they eliminated lockers because they needed the space for them, so. So then the value of homes is so high that they get a lot of money per child. Plus, the parents raised over, you know, a ton of money for them as well. So, point being, you know, if we could reach out to the world or really anybody, but it'd be interesting. Is it just those rich places, Winnetka, Wilmette, just pulling it out of their pocket, or, you know, what resources?
You
just network, I suppose, see what other districts are doing.
I will tell you that Mrs. Paulson, as her role as president of the CUSD200 Foundation, is networked with a lot of other school foundations in the area. I mean, so that's being done, and I think we could help the foundation. Right now, they need board members, and so if any of you have recommendations. People you would like to see on board, and Dr. and my fellow board members now, let me know, and we'll get those people in touch with the CUSD200 Foundation if they're interested, and we'll get them on the board. What we really need is the critical mass of people who know other people who then could carry the message forward. And that's the struggle, because the foundation got so small that now to build on it, we're not at the critical mass where we can do anything. I mean, what is done this year was amazing with the amount of manpower that we had to work with. And yes, Mrs. Lockenau has been helping us a great deal from the district perspective. So that's all working, but, you know, if we want to get to the point where the COD Foundation is, and if you want to talk about alumni, I'm happy to talk to you offline about that, because it's a little different with college alumni than it is with high school alumni. Not a little different, a lot different. And it's very tricky. But anyway, that's how we can help the foundation. And I agree, you know, with what Mrs. Cockhill said. It's not only high taxes, it's people taking money out of their pocket who believe in education and making some significant donations.
Any further comments or suggestions?
Yeah.
Brad?
I think we're missing the obvious. The Community Advisor Committee is a big initiative. Maybe that needs to be one of the goals.
Wrestle with that a little bit. I mean, I think I heard a number of different concepts around leveraging and maximizing partnerships, of which I think CAC is probably one that could be kind of illustrated in that. But I think, you know, even Jim, to a lot of your questions or thoughts around, you know, the, you know, alternate sources of revenue, alumni, those are all things that the foundation sort of has, you know, a thumbprint on trying to to kind of get a handle on. So I think in large part, rather than chasing all those areas ourselves, I think if we could put more energy behind leveraging support of their effort to focus on those areas, I could see kind of a partnership goal growing with a couple of different facets to it. So I think what I heard out of conversation today, let me just see if I can summarize and tell me if I missed it. So kind of that conversation we just had around partnerships, obviously the continued focus on facilities and the master plan, kind of the continued focus around technology, that sort of the learning environment around technology and just sort of what does that universal access mean, you know, look like. I think we've been really conscious of you know, the device, but also the focus on development and learning environment sort of parallel to, you know, the growth in devices. So I think kind of that focus in that area, and then I think in the student learning, I think kind of the interest in science and the focus on SEL, social emotional learning.
You did mention teacher evaluation process, so if that's going to be a big chunk of time that's going to somehow trump some of these other areas, you might, you know, because I mean, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 boxes circled, and I didn't even circle technology, so that's a lot.
We'll get it done. So if board would be okay with this, let us, senior leadership team, kind of take this feedback and see if we can develop them into some goal plans like we did last year. So I've spent a lot of time here at the table kind of wordsmithing and wrestling with goal plans. Let us take a shot at a draft that we can bring back to you to give us some feedback. Great. The good news is we're several months ahead of where we were in this discussion a year ago, so we're doing well in terms of, I think, our ability to really kind of have these priorities identified, you know, moving into this school year. So we'll take this, wrestle with it a little bit, and try to bring a draft back to you in August to critique.
We'll then move on to the third and last discussion item, which is board representation on the collective bargaining teams. And again, Dr. Schuler, is there any information from staff you need to hear?
No, I think most of the information, I think, was in the agenda packet. So this was something that had been requested by board members really over the last couple of meetings. There's been some discussion about it, and so I think we wanted to bring it to the forefront in terms of discussion. I'm not sure there's actually a decision to be made right now around this, simply based on the fact that you do have two existing collective bargaining agreements that run over the next couple of years. And I think, as I mentioned, the board packet, typically at the point in which you sit down to begin the process of bargaining, the very first decision that the board makes is what is the composition of the bargaining team. Factually speaking, it will probably not be this board that's sitting around the table right now that will be the board sitting around the table when you're ready to make that decision. So I think okay and valuable discussion. I'm not sure there's action to be had around this right now, just because I'm not sure if this board that will be making that decision, you know, a couple of years from now. But, you know, kind of with that said, I don't have any other background information.
Let me just share some thinking I've given on this topic. I've talked to many of you about committees, and I'm not ready to make permanent appointments tonight for committees, but I'm getting close. And one of the committees we have is the Human Resources Policy Committee. And my thought was, that once that committee is formed, that I would ask that committee to do a number of things. One of them would be to start looking at what other districts have done with respect to the composition of their collective bargaining team, whether they've had board members on it. I'm sure that I know they have. There are other districts that have. What's been the issues that's raised,
what are the challenges, what are the benefits, you start doing some research on that so that we can have perhaps a more meaningful discussion about this topic sometime in the future, and not the too distant future, but to get some crystallization. You have some legwork done by that committee before we have a full-fledged discussion on it. That Human Resources Committee could also start looking and doing some research, for example, on salary schedules. What replaces them? How are they, what are the mechanisms that need to be looked at to replace a salary schedule with some other sort of measure of compensation? And again, that's something we would really start diving into in January 2016 when there's going to be a joint committee that's going to be formed. But I don't want to prohibit or in any way inhibit any discussion on this topic tonight, but that's my thinking. And so it's a topic of the composition of a collective bargaining team will certainly be a topic we'll be addressing again in the future. But if we want to spend some time on it tonight, I'm willing to do that.
You know, I think, again, during various campaigns, this topic came up. And again, I think there, you know, I like to see the follow through for those people that are elected that have made those comments, number one. Number two, I think there's, you know, I'd rather have this in place before we have the, you know, the next negotiation session. And number three, I think there's wording in the contract that says, you know, if there's some catastrophic change or significant change or whatever in the funding that affects the district, there could be a modification of the contract. I would prefer to have this kind of organization or group in play if that were to occur. I mean, we, in this last year, we were challenged by what we'll call Senate Bill 16 or 1 or whatever it is. You know, I think we are, you know, we're on the cliff of seeing a lot of other potential financial impact. So I think I personally would like to see this done as soon as possible, both as a, you know, a fulfillment of the comments. You know, I think most everybody that got elected was making that comment that we should have of that, and maybe I'm wrong, but, you know, but even if we didn't, I'm a strong proponent. I think we should have board representation in it, and it should be in place so that if the time comes, whether it's the next contract or something in between, that we're in position and ready to go.
Any other comments, discussion?
So what kind of direction are we trying to get? We're trying to I see the Human Resources Committee here. We talked about the salary schedule. We talked about collective bargaining teams. What we can discuss, what direction are we trying to get?
Well, I think that's what I struggle with. And that's why I thought I would delegate to the Human Resources Committee the first task of perhaps helping us identify the issues and coming up with suggestions and then bringing it back to the board at the appropriate time. If it looks like that something will trigger a reopening of discussions under the collective bargaining agreement, we'll certainly ask the members of that committee to accelerate their deliberations and present something in a timely fashion to the board so that we can have a structured discussion at that time.
And that committee would have two board members on that committee. So
yes, that committee would have two board members and plus members of the senior administrative staff that Dr. Schuler would appoint. Seeing no further discussion, we'll move on to written reports. We've all received the monthly financial reports and the copies of the FOIA requests that have been received and responded to. Next item is reports from board members. Are there any board committee reports?
Okay, I'll make one on facilities. After our last meeting, I'll make this quick, I promise. After our last meeting, we had a kickoff with Perkins Will and what's going to probably become the Oversight Committee on June 25th. We talked about the process that we'll undertake over the next 10 to 12 months. We talked about the members of the oversight committee, which is possibly different than any kind of citizen involvement. Had a good discussion about the history of facility improvements and how we got to the point that we're at right now. And probably most importantly, to kick off that process, we're going to Perkins and Wilson and kind of lead a visioning session with our teachers and principals, well, principals primarily, as part of an already scheduled day on August 10th to talk about evolution of educational facilities and how they impact and support teaching and learning. So that's the next big step. I know it was mentioned earlier that Mr. Robinson was out with members of that team today. So the process that we approved at the last meeting is fully underway, and I might have to get a report every month for the next 10 months.
With respect to other board reports, I just want to reemphasize that I am in the process of finalizing the committee assignments, and I will do so here in the next several weeks. I need to just talk to one more board member. And in response to Joanne's question earlier this evening about how the committees will be addressing the challenges we have, I mentioned how it's important that all of these committees, all of our committees, will have to be working hand in hand towards this common goal of meeting the challenges. That was not an original thought with me. I was meeting with Mr. Paulson this morning, and he expressed to me his observation of, was it mature? And we had big challenges to meet, although they have the resources to meet some of those challenges. But he saw that district and how their committees worked so well together and achieved a goal. And so I credit Mr. Paulson for planting that seed with me. And I'm going to make sure that all of our committees are trying to work coordinated together towards a common goal so that we can achieve what we need to achieve. Any questions or comments? Okay, topics for future discussion. Believe it or not, we're going to be discussing the 2015-2016 budget on August 12th, probably the end of September. And just so everyone is advised, the May 25, 2016 Committee of the Whole has been removed from the board's schedule. We have found that largely unnecessary, and it's certainly a busy, busy time. We have another Committee of the Whole meeting at that time at the end of May. Our next regular board meeting will be August 12 at 7:30 p.m. And do we have any public comments on non-agenda items? Seeing none, there being no further action to come before the board, no open session, I will ask for a motion and a second to adjourn the meeting. So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Matheson. Moved by Mr. Matheson and seconded by Mrs. Coghill. I can call for a voice call on this. All right. All those in favor of adjournment, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
No one's opposed, so we are adjourned.
Somebody to vote on that?